Hello, I'm Erick Remer from the Cleveland Clinic, and today I'll be discussing a case-based review of common scrotal pathologies. I have no disclosures related to this presentation. Also, I'd like to acknowledge one of my resident colleagues, Dr. David Sweet, for helping to prepare some of this material. We'll be discussing a number of scrotal pathologies today, including presentation of the acute scrotum, that is swelling with or without pain, calcifications, scrotal cysts, masses, extratesticular lesions, and finally scrotal trauma. The first case is that of a 17-year-old with acute onset right scrotal pain that has lasted for 10 hours. We see sagittal and transverse images of the right testis with a transverse image of the left testis for comparison. Color Doppler shows no flow within the right testis and normal appearing flow in the left testis. So, in summary, we have heterogeneous right testicular echotexture and no flow on color Doppler exam. So then, our differential diagnosis for acute scrotal pain includes testicular torsion, torsion of a testicular appendage, epididymorachitis, hemorrhage or infarction of a neoplasm, an incarcerated hernia, or trauma. And this patient had testicular torsion. The most common causes of acute scrotal pain in adults include testicular torsion in about 20% and acute epididymorachitis or epididymitis in 80%. Torsion is most common cause of acute scrotal pain in adolescents. And one cannot distinguish torsion from other abnormalities by physical exam in about 50% of patients. The extent of ischemia is directly related to the degree of testicular torsion, with complete torsion comprising over 360 to 450 degrees of twist, depending on what literature you read. Of the two types of torsion, intravaginal torsion is more common. This occurs when there's complete investment of the testis and epididymis by the tunica vaginalis, allowing it to rotate within the tunicle sac, the so-called bell clapper deformity. The salvage rate of testicular parenchyma from ischemia diminishes over time, but is 80 to 100% if surgery is performed within 5 to 6 hours after the onset of symptoms. Doppler ultrasound helps differentiate torsion from epididymorchitis. Here we see an example of an ischemic testis both on a pathological specimen and on ultrasound. Grayscale ultrasound findings. For the first 1 to 3 hours after the onset of torsion, testicular echogenicity is normal. Later, there's enlargement and increased or heterogeneous echogenicity in the testis, as we saw in our index case. Extratesticular findings can occur, and these include an enlarged epididymis with skin thickening and hydrocele. The whirlpool sign is the most specific sign of testicular torsion and describes a twisted cord at the external inguinal ring with or without an ovoid curled echogenic mass that represents the epididymis, cord, and vessels, as we see in this image here. There's no flow within the testis. There's this curvilinear echogenic mass, the whirlpool sign. Keep in mind that when one is trying to assess for testicular torsion, one should optimize Doppler technique for slow flow. This includes decreasing the wall filter, decreasing the pulse repetition frequency or scale, increasing the Doppler gain, and being sure to document flow with spectral Doppler. A definitive diagnosis on Doppler exam relies on flow on the normal side, but absent flow on the affected side, and has a sensitivity of somewhere between 80 and 90%. With incomplete torsion that is less than 360 degrees, some arterial flow may persist in the affected testis, and a tardis parvis waveform may be present. So then let's look at a case of incomplete or partial torsion. This was a 10-year-old with left testicular pain and swelling upon waking, with nausea and vomiting and absent cremasteric reflex. Variable flow can be seen with partial torsion. One should use power Doppler to show slow flow when color flow is absent. Generally, the grayscale ultrasound is likely normal or may only show mild enlargement due to delayed ischemic changes. Again, the whirlpool sign is the most specific finding, particularly when testicular flow is preserved. Here we see an example marked by the arrows of a whirlpool sign. There is no flow within the left testis on the color Doppler image, but signal is found on spectral Doppler imaging. This patient went to surgery and was found to have a 360th degree torsion with a viable testis, and bilateral orchiopexy was performed. Also note that this patient had testicular microlithiasis, which we'll discuss later. We'll now examine two last forms of torsion. First, subacute torsion. This was a 4-year-old with nausea, vomiting, and abdominal pain for a day before its parents noticed an abnormal gait and discovered left scrotal swelling and pain. Subacute torsion refers to delayed presentation and misdiagnosis after 24 hours of symptom onset and, of course, impacts testicular viability. Common features of subacute torsion include atypical presentations, commonly with isolated abdominal pain, presentation in patients with developmental, cognitive, or social disorders, in patients who are young or children and adolescents who hide or minimize scrotal pain. This patient went for emergent exploration, was confirmed to have a 360-degree torsion with testicular infarction. We can see the markedly heterogeneous testis marked by the arrows with lack of color Doppler flow. This patient underwent orchiectomy. Lastly, this is a 16-year-old with acute left-sided pain and swelling while lifting weights that had improved by the time of presentation for medical care. We can see that the color Doppler exam and grayscale images show normal testicular parenchyma, but a swirling of the left spermatic cord and vessels, the whirlpool sign, with a heterogeneously echogenic pseudomass below the point of torsion. There was color Doppler flow within the testis, however, and spectral Doppler waveforms could be obtained showing tardis parvis waveform. This patient had intermittent torsion or torsion detorsion, which is characterized by acute onset of unilateral pain of short duration that spontaneously resolves and tends to recur. Adolescents are most commonly affected by this disorder and have multiple episodes prior to surgery, on average about 4. Ultrasound findings depend on the severity and duration of the torsion and time between the detorsion and the ultrasound performance. Reperfusion after early ischemia can induce a reactive hyperemia that is sonographically indistinguishable from epididymorchitis, so a waxing and waning scrotal pain and signs of infection must be integrated into the clinical evaluation to help differentiate intermittent torsion from epididymorchitis. The next patient is a 10-year-old with 10 days of increasing right scrotal pain, swelling, and erythema. We can see an echogenic mass above the level of the testicle marked by the calipers that is associated with the epididymal head and has no color signal. There are a number of normal scrotal appendages that are vestigial remnants along the testis or epididymis that have a variety of morphologies, including sessile, stalk-like, or pedunculated variants. The appendix testis is present in over 80% of children, but there are appendix epididymis, paraepididymis, the vas aberrans as well. So on the right, we see examples of an appendix epididymis extending off the epididymal head, appendix testis extending off the upper aspect of the testis near the epididymal head, both a rounded variant and a more pedunculated stalk-like variant. So this patient then had a torus appendage epididymis. Torus testicular appendages are the most common cause of acute scrotal pain in the prepubertal age group. The appendices are freely mobile at their attachment sites, and it's said that the stalk-like morphology has the highest likelihood of torsion. The appendix testis accounts for about 92% of all causes of appendage torsion, And patients tend to typically present with a more gradual onset of pain than testicular torsion, often having pain for several days, usually limited to the upper pole of the testis. About a third of patients have the pathognomonic scrotal bluish nodule on the skin, the so-called blue dot sign. These patients are treated non-surgically with bed rest and non-steroidals. So again, one will expect to see a round extratesticular mass with increased or mixed echogenicity without Doppler flow. And one may see an enlarged epididymal head, hydrocele, and scrotal skin thickening as well. The next patient is a 52-year-old with right scrotal pain and swelling after right nephrectomy and lymph node dissection. We can see an elliptical to wedge-shaped area of decreased echogenicity within the upper pole of the testis without flow on color Doppler imaging. And this patient turns out to have segmental testicular infarction, which is a rare disorder that usually occurs in patients 20 to 30 years of age. And this represents an area of partial ischemia, which is usually associated with either infectious etiologies or hematologic disorders such as sickle cell or vasculitis. This abnormality can mimic a testicular neoplasm on ultrasound, and in these patients, MRI can be useful for confirmation. This is another 52-year-old with left groin pain and subjectively a fever for several days. We can see that the ultrasound shows a somewhat wedge-shaped area of decreased echogenicity within the periphery of the testis without significant flow on color Doppler. This was felt to be nonspecific, and this patient went on to MRI, where we can see a hydrocele surrounding the testis on the T2-weighted image and a somewhat wedge-shaped area of decreased enhancement corresponding to the ultrasound finding. These findings are characteristic of testicular infarction, but at times, short-term interval follow-up with ultrasound can be used rather than MRI. Conservative treatment is the standard of care. The next case of acute scrotal pain is a 41-year-old with pain after heavy lifting 4 days earlier. We can see transverse and longitudinal images of the scrotum, specifically the epididymis, in grayscale and in color Doppler. Our imaging findings on grayscale ultrasound include marked epididymal thickening with some hypoechogenicity and overlying skin thickening with a small hydrocele. On Doppler, we see increased color signal both within the epididymis and testis. If we briefly review acute scrotal pain, again, we've discussed torsion, testicular appendage torsion, and now this patient has epididymoarchitis. Epididymitis and epididymoarchitis are the most common causes of acute scrotal pain in the adult population. Most common pathogens depend on the patient's age. In sexually active men less than 35 years old, chlamydia and Neisseria gonorrhea are most common, whereas in children or men over 35 years of age, urinary tract pathogens such as E. coli and Pseudomonas are seen. The infection progresses retrograde to the epididymal tail, body, head, and then testis. So it may involve only the epididymis and cause epididymitis, or involve both the epididymis and testis and cause epididymoarchitis. As we've seen, the epididymis is typically enlarged, heterogeneous. There can be reactive changes within the skin, and on color Doppler imaging, there's marked hyperemia. Epididymoarchitis describes progression of infection from the epididymis to include the testis as well. Epididymitis with orchitis occurs in about 20 to 40% of patients. The preen sign describes pain improving when the testis is elevated above the pubic symphysis, but this is thought to be a somewhat unreliable sign. Keep in mind that the urinalysis may be abnormal in patients with infectious epididymitis or epididymoarchitis, but is normal in patients with torsion. Next is a 50-year-old man with scrotal swelling and pain for about a month that acutely worsened over 3 days. The power Doppler image shows a complex collection with an enlarged epididymal head, It contains internal septa and low-level echoes consistent with debris. There's surrounding hyperemia. And there's also complex fluid with internal echoes surrounding the epididymis as seen on the lower image. This patient turns out to have epididymitis that progressed to abscess. This can be seen as a focal complex fluid collection with peripheral but no internal vascularity. Other complications of epididymitis and epididymorchitis include pyoceal, which describes pus collecting between the layers of the tunica vaginalis, often containing debris and septa, as we saw in this abscess, and also testicular ischemia, as epididymal edema compresses testicular veins, typically the draining veins. Ischemia of either the epididymis or epididymis and testis can occur. We'll now move on to this 57-year-old man with left scrotal pain. He had a past medical history of urothelial carcinoma of the bladder that was treated with transurethral resection and intravesical BCG therapy. We can see images of the epididymis that show marked enlargement with heterogeneous masses denoted by the arrows, with relatively little hyperemia, especially in comparison to bacterial epididymitis. As you're aware, intravesical BCG is an immunotherapy for non-muscle invasive bladder cancer and comes along with a number of different complications, each relatively uncommon. And these include contaminated urine that can cause cystitis, pyelonephritis from reflux, renal abscesses, epididymitis, granulomatous prostatitis, and balanitis. It's said that local complications can occur in up to 63% of patients. And again, keep in mind, key here is that the epididymis, while enlarged, is considerably less hyperemic than one would see in bacterial epididymitis. We'll now move on to testicular calcifications. This is an asymptomatic 37-year-old with a history of trauma. We can see multiple punctate echogenic foci within the testis without shadowing. If we move on then to the differential diagnosis, we ask ourselves, is there really one? There is a differential diagnosis for solitary calcifications that includes trauma, infection, infarction, or a tumor, but multifocal 2 to 3 millimeter calcifications without shadowing is diagnostic for testicular microlithiasis. Testicular microlithiasis is usually incidentally discovered, and again, it's comprised of 2 to 3 millimeter calcifications in the seminiferous tubules. There should be 5 or greater within one view of the testis. It's usually bilateral, can be unilateral in cryptorchid testes, as we see in this example above, and has a number of associations, again, including cryptorchidism, Klinefelter syndrome, Peutz-Jeghers disease, Down syndrome, male pseudohermaphroditism. This disorder occurs in up to 9% of symptomatic adults and somewhere between 2.5% and 5.5% in asymptomatic adults. Testicular microlithiasis indicates a premalignant change only in patients with additional risk factors for testicular carcinoma. It's felt that if there are no risk factors for testicular carcinoma, the risk if testicular microlithiasis is present is extremely small, with a worst-case estimate of 1 in 100. So then, current recommendations per this article from AJR in 2016 include monthly testicular self-examination, with follow-up ultrasound being reserved for high-risk patients, including patients with a personal history or family history of testicular carcinoma, history of testicular male descent or cryptorchidism, atrophy, or infertility. There are several other intrascrotal calcifications, and these include scrotalus from inflammation of the tunica vaginalis, or torsion of the appendix testis that then detaches and travels within the scrotal sac. There can also be tunica albuginea calcifications that are non-mobile. Now we'll examine several intratesticular cystic lesions. This was a 41-year-old with a palpable scrotal mass. We can see sagittal and transverse grayscale images that show fluid-filled network of structures that coalesce on the mediastinum. There's an associated spermatocele and hydrocele as seen on the transverse image. And if we were to put color Doppler on this, we would see no flow. The differential diagnosis for an intratesticular cystic lesion includes tubular ectasia of the reedy testis, as seen in our index case, also benign cyst, intratesticular varicocele, a cystic neoplasm, or an abscess. Cystic dilatation of the reedy testis has the characteristic appearance and location that we see in this case. There are fluid-filled tubular structures coalescing on the mediastinum. Tends to occur in men greater than 55 years of age and results from obliteration of the efferent ductules, is often associated with the spermatocele, and is a benign finding that requires no additional follow-up. Other testicular cysts include tunica albuginea cysts that may be embryologic in origin. They're typically palpable due to their subcapsular location, and are usually less than 10 millimeters and may be uni or multilocular. And we see two examples here of more sizable tunica albuginea cysts. Here another patient with cysts within the testis, these somewhat larger and more central in location. Simple intratesticular cysts may result from trauma or infection. They may be in or adjacent to the reedy testis, but are not palpable since they're central within the testis. Again, they may be associated with spermatoceles. Most are between 2 and 18 millimeters. And they can mimic testicular neoplasms, but generally are more simple in appearance. Sometimes neoplasms have cystic components as well. So about 60% of non-seminomatous germ cell tumors may have cystic components, particularly teratomas. Here we see an example of an intratesticular mass with both cystic and solid elements that turned out to be a teratoma. We'll move on to the next case of a 36-year-old with a history of trauma. We see a well-defined, homogeneous, hypoechoic intratesticular mass on the right. On color Doppler imaging, we see mild internal flow. Contrast that with this 26-year-old with right testicular pain and swelling after trauma. Color Doppler ultrasound shows a well-circumscribed, mildly heterogeneous, solid-appearing mass without internal flow. As this ultrasound was not entirely conclusive, the patient went on to MRI for further evaluation. T2-weighted images show a well-circumscribed, complex mass with both cystic and solid components, which we can see as enhancing on the post-contrast image. This patient went to right orchiectomy and was found to have a mixed germ cell neoplasm that was primarily teratoma. Keep in mind that 10 to 15% of testicular tumors are found incidentally after trauma. Then the differential diagnosis for an intratesticular mass is neoplasm, neoplasm, and neoplasm, as this needs to be excluded for any patient presenting with a mass within the testis itself. Other disorders are considerably less common and include abscess, hematoma, epidermoid cyst, and other much less common disorders. A few points about testicular neoplasms. They comprise about 1% of all neoplasms in men, but are the most common malignancy in the young adult population. They present as a painless mass or with vague discomfort. About 10% of patients will have acute symptoms either related to trauma or metastatic disease. About 95% of testicular tumors are of germ cell origin, with seminoma being the most common pure germ cell tumor, comprising about 35 to 50%. The majority of testicular tumors are hypoechoic, but they can have variable heterogeneity and may have calcification or cystic changes. We see three different examples here, the first with cystic change, the other mildly heterogeneous with prominent vascular flow, and the third a very small, well-defined hypoechoic lesion. Metastases are via lymphatic routes along the testicular veins and have well-defined landing sites in the upper retroperitoneum. On the right, the aortic cable nodes at L2, on the left, the periaortic nodes, and there is some crossover from right to left at the level of the cisterna chyli. Distant metastatic disease occurs due to hematogenous spread to lungs, liver, brain, and bone. Here we see a left periaortic lymph node with left hydronephrosis. Seminoma has the best prognosis as it is both chemo and radiation sensitive, and again comprises up to 50% of germ cell tumors. It's most common around age 40. Patients will have elevated beta-HCG, but never alpha-fetoprotein. And these tumors tend to be homogeneous and hypoechoic and may replace the entire testis as well. 25% have lymphatic spread at the time of presentation. And here we see four different patients with seminoma. Again, typically well-defined hypoechoic. And as we see in the MRI image, replacing the whole testis. Lymphoma involves the testis in an older patient population and is the most common testicular tumor in patients over 60. Its involvement is more common secondarily, with primary testicular lymphoma rather uncommon. It can be bilateral in up to 40% of patients and is seen as a focal hypoechoic mass or diffuse testicular enlargement. Extension into the epididymis and spermatic cord is common, and hyperemia is characteristic on color Doppler imaging. Here we see grayscale and color Doppler images of testicular lymphoma. Last is the so-called burned-out germ cell neoplasm that has the eponym Azapardi tumor. It is commonly a teratocarcinoma or choriocarcinoma that undergoes rapid growth, outstripping its blood supply, with then regression, fibrosis, and scarring. It often presents with metastatic disease at another site and is seen on ultrasound as a focally calcified small mass within the testis. We'll discuss one other intratesticular mass, and that is the epidermoid cyst. Typically presents around 20 to 40 years of age as a non-tender 1 to 3 centimeter lesion within the testis. It is of germ cell origin, can have a fibrous wall that may be calcified with a layer of squamous epithelium, and contains thick, pasty squamous epithelium and keratin debris. It has no malignant potential, so if it can be identified prospectively, then either interval surveillance or testicular sparing surgery can be performed. Epidermoid cysts have a variable appearance on ultrasound. The most characteristic is the onion ring appearance with concentric rings of hyper and hypoechogenicity, as we see in the first case. A target or bullseye echogenic focus can also be seen, and it represents compacted keratinized debris, as we see in the second case. The third typical appearance is that of a hyperechoic rim due to a dense fibrous or calcified capsule. The next patient is a 28-year-old with infertility. We see an extra testicular abnormality that is manifested as multiple serpentine hypoechoic structures, typically posterior to the testis along the epididymis, and these distend with Valsalva and in the upright position and show pronounced color Doppler signal. Our differential diagnosis for an extratesticular lesion should include varicocele, as we saw in our index case, spermatocele, a mass within the spermatic cord such as a lipoma or liposarcoma or rhabdomyosarcoma in children, or an epididymal mass such as an adenomatoid tumor. Varicoceles are dilated tortuous veins of the pampiniform plexus that lies posterior to the testis. It should be examined in supine position with Valsalva maneuver and in the upright position. It causes impaired drainage of blood into the cord and is seen in about 15% of adult men and one-third of men who are infertile. It is the most common correctable cause of male infertility. Only about 60% of varicoceles in infertile men are palpable, and sperm quality improves after treatment in about 50%. primary or idiopathic varicoceles are due to incompetent valves in the internal spermatic vein. 98% occur on the left, and up to 70% are bilateral. Secondary varicoceles occur due to increased pressure from hydronephrosis or an adjacent mass. Classically, one has been taught to rule out a neoplasm if there is a new or non-compressible right varicocele. However, recent series have found this to occur in only about 4% of patients, and all of these patients had other findings indicative of retroperitoneal mass. Treatment is either surgical ligation or embolization. Varicoceles may also be intratesticular or intra and extra testicular. These tend to cause pain from congestion and stretching of the tunica albuginea. You see an example here on grayscale ultrasound, a linear hypoechoic structure traversing the testis that fills with color on color Doppler imaging. Paratesticular tumors are rare. The most common is the adenomatoid tumor. These comprise about 30% of paratesticular tumors and are most often found incidentally as a painless firm mass, often within the tail of the epididymis. They have variable echogenicity. We see three examples here. Each is distinctly separate from the testis, of varying size and echogenicity. There are a number of spermatic cord tumors that can occur. Most are benign cord lipomas, as we see in the image here, a uniformly hyperechoic mass that is separate from the testis. About 25% are malignant, and most are liposarcomas, with rhabdomyoma or rhabdomyosarcoma occurring in infants and children. We will finish with findings in testicular trauma. The first patient is a 58-year-old with right testicular swelling after being hit by a baseball 1 week earlier. We see a linear hypoechoic fracture line extending across the testicular parenchyma, marked by the arrows, with preservation of the tunica albuginea. There is a small associated hematocele, and color Doppler flow shows preserved flow within the surrounding testicular parenchyma. A fracture is a break in the parenchyma. If flow is normal in the surrounding tissue, conservative management may be employed. The right testis is often anatomically higher than the left, and so it is more commonly injured with blunt trauma as it contacts the pubic symphysis. Again, on grayscale imaging, a linear hypoechoic band is seen. Tunica albuginea is preserved. There may be a hematocele or a testicular hematoma. Again, fracture without disruption of the tunica can be managed conservatively if perfusion is preserved. The next patient is a 14-year-old with left scrotal pain 5 days after being kneed in the groin at wrestling camp. It shows focal disruption of the tunica albuginea marked by the arrow, with heterogeneous material extending beyond the expected margin of the testis encompassed by the circle. This material indicates extruded testicular parenchyma. There is also a hematocele and absent flow within the extruded parenchyma and preserved flow throughout the remainder of the testis. So testicular rupture indicates disruption of the tunica albuginea, often with extrusion of parenchyma with or without hematocele. There may be edema within the epididymis and or scrotal wall, and hematomas may be seen as well. There may be focal or diffuse loss of vascularity, and this disorder commonly requires surgical debridement. Ultrasound is 100% sensitive for rupture. And this is a urological emergency. Prompt treatment reduces infection, atrophy, and necrosis. On exploration, this patient was found to have rupture with extruded parenchyma as seen on the ultrasound, with approximately 50% of testicular parenchyma viable. Last case is a 53-year-old with right scrotal swelling 1 week after being hit by a baseball. We see three circumscribed mixed echogenicity areas within the right testis without flow. These are compatible with subacute hematomas. There's also a peritesticular hematocele. Hematomas may be intratesticular, extratesticular in the epididymis or scrotal wall, or between the visceral and parietal layers of the tunica vaginalis, in other words, a metasele. Conservative management can be pursued for small intratesticular hematomas, subcutaneous hematomas without hematocele, or small hematoceles with intact tunica albuginea. Large hematomas, however, require surgical exploration. The appearance of the hematoma relates to the time frame in which it is examined, so acute hematomas tend to be hyperechoic, with increasing complexity and decreasing echogenicity over time. If conservative management is pursued, serial ultrasound should be performed in the first 72 hours to confirm stability. If the patient has increasing pain or there's hematoma expansion, then surgical exploration should occur. In conclusion, ultrasound is the mainstay of scrotal imaging. MRI can be used to augment or clarify findings on ultrasound. The differential diagnosis before imaging is heavily dependent on patient history and presenting symptoms, and I've hoped to review most of the common scrotal pathologies that one will encounter. Thanks for your attention.